Corporate will. Corporate will is a concept in company law, which is an assumption which is made that there is a will or a wall between the directors and the outside world. So the directors are always getting the protection of the corporate will. So let us say that, for example, this is the will, this is the shield. So they are getting the protection. So the directors are given this protection with a good intention that let them do the work without any fear. However, this same corporate will can be misused by the directors. So the outside world, if they want to ask anything to the company, they are going to face the corporate will. It's an assumption in company law. So it's like a will or a shield or a wall, we can say anything. So directors can do any actions and they will be protected by the corporate will. So we cannot go and ask why the directors did that, why the directors did this, because they are under the assumption that they are doing the work in good faith, they are doing bona fide work. Because they are doing bona fide work, they have been given a protection of corporate will. So the separate personality of the company gives this advantage of a corporate will. However, the director should use this for legitimate and proper valid legal business. There is sometimes where the directors may use this as a fraudulent manner. So they will say, I don't know, the company has done it, because they have the corporate will. So in normal circumstances, we cannot question the directors if they have done everything in good faith. So the general assumption is also that since the shareholders will appoint the director, the assumption is that the directors will act in good faith, the directors will do their work properly, and the directors are there for the benefit of the company. So this is corporate will. Before we understand lifting of corporate will and the other concepts, we should know that the general rule is that of corporate will, which protects the directors from any questioning from outside authorities, because the directors are acting in good faith. So the outside world, anything question they ask, the directors are protected by the will. It is like a shield, so they will not be getting attacked directly. And this will give the freedom for directors and also to do the work properly. Otherwise, if there is no corporate will, directors will think how I will be affected properly. Even if I do some work genuinely, the company or the outside world may blame me. But the protection of corporate will help the directors to function properly. But sometimes the directors may do something in a fraudulent manner or any sort of cheating by misusing the corporate will. Because corporate will says that we cannot question the directors directly, and the assumption is that directors are doing work in good faith and they are protected by the corporate will. So you cannot go and see what is behind the will or the wall or the shield. In lifting of corporate will, we try to understand when we can make sure and ask the question to the directors. So court is the only authority. Court can lift the concept of corporate will, and the court can lift the corporate will and order investigation if there is any fraud. So court can lift the corporate will. So please understand, only the court, nobody else can lift the corporate will. The general assumption is we should give the freedom and flexibility to director, and we should give them the option to run the company as he may deem fit, because the assumption is he's doing his job properly. So only the court can lift the corporate will. When can the court lift the corporate will? When there is reasonable doubt. Court feels there is something problem. The directors may be doing something fraudulently. So when there is reasonable doubt, the court can lift the corporate will and then they can order investigation. So this reasonable doubt, we will study different case laws. So court will look behind the corporate entity and take action against directors. So what the court will do, it will look beyond the wheel or the corporate wheel, the corporate entity or the corporate protection, and then it will take action against the directors. So please remember, if directors are acting genuinely, they don't have to fear, there is nothing to worry. But if the director has done some fraud, they have to worry, because court has the power to lift the corporate wheel. The corporate wheel has to be lifted for the benefit of the company. So we have to understand that the shareholders cannot ask lifting of corporate wheel for personal reasons. So personal reasons, they cannot, it should affect the company as a whole. If they ask the court to lift the corporate wheel for personal reason, every other day court has to order investigation against the directors. Only if the company as a whole has been affected, shareholders as a whole has been affected, then we can lift the corporate wheel. So the shareholders cannot ask lifting of corporate wheel for personal use, and this has been told in the case of Premalata Bhatia versus Union of India. So Premalata Bhatia versus Union of India. So this was a case which was told, telling that shareholders cannot ask for lifting of the corporate wheel for personal purposes. So as I already told you, court can lift the corporate wheel. Only the court can lift. Yes, shareholder can go and ask, but the reason should be affecting the company as a whole. If the company as a whole is affected, then we can lift the corporate wheel. In Companies Act 2013, so when I write CA 2013, many places in this course, it means Companies Act 2013. Companies Act 2013. So in Companies Act 2013, there is statutory recognition for lifting the corporate wheel. That means, when can we order investigation against the directors? It was not there in Companies Act 1956. So the statutory recognition for lifting of corporate wheel has been given in Companies Act 2013, which is under, the first one is Section 7, subsection 7. If there is any fraud at the time of incorporation, so incorporation documents are false, then we can go for lifting of corporate wheel. Or we can also go for lifting of corporate wheel under Section 251. So 251 is basically, if there is a wrong application for removal of name. Or in 339, we can lift the corporate wheel if there is any fraud application with respect to the finding up of the company. So it is basically fraudulent conduct at the time of winding up. So if there is fraudulent conduct at the time of winding up, that time also we can lift the corporate wheel. So this is very important. We have statutory recognition within the act. The sections I already told you, 7, 251 and 339. So this gives the statutory recognition. Over and above this also, we can lift the corporate wheel based on case to case basis of that particular company. So court can decide if it wants to lift the corporate wheel based on case to case basis. And this is the advantage in lifting the corporate wheel. We will now try to understand some of the cases of lifting of corporate wheel. Let us look at some cases to understand lifting of corporate wheel. So the first case is lifting of corporate wheel when company wants to evade taxes. So this is the case of Sir Dinsha Manakji Petted. So this is All India Reporter 1927, Bombay High Court. That is page number 371. Don't have to worry about the citation. Let us try to understand when the court can lift the corporate veil. So in this, what happens is there is a very wealthy man. So let us call him as Dinsha Monarchji. So he is the wealthy man who is there and he is having some income. So what is his income? Dividend plus interest income. So let us say he is getting 10 lakhs income. So this is 1927. 10 lakhs is a very big amount. So 10 lakhs he is getting income. And what he is getting income is through dividends and interest which he has put in the bank. So to avoid the tax, what he was doing is he formed four companies. Company A, B, C and D. And in these companies, he divided 2.5 lakhs each as the income. So he was giving this dividend interest to these companies. What these companies used to do, they used to give it back to him and call it as a loan. So they used to give it the money back to him as a loan. Basically, he is taking a route to evade taxes. So here, the corporate veil was lifted and told that the company was formed only to evade taxes. This A, B, C, D has no business of its own. Their only business is to get income from dividend and give loan to this person. So it has no business of its own, no business of its own. And that is why the corporate veil can be lifted and the director can be punished. So what is this case? Lifting of corporate veil when the company is trying to evade taxes. So in this case, the corporate veil is lifted and we can tell that this person is trying to evade taxes. So that is when the corporate veil can be lifted. The next case is lifting of corporate veil when company acted against public policy of the particular country. So here we have an example of the case of Connor Brothers versus Connor. So this is 1940 case. So this is an England case. So in England, what happens is there is a company and that company shareholders are German people. So it is controlled by German. So shareholders. So it is an England company. It is registered in England, but it is having shareholders. So you can have anybody as shareholder, no? So the shareholder 100% control is by Germany. And at this time, what happens is England and Germany is at war. So we have world war going on. So England is one side, Germany is another side. Like how we have India, Pakistan, there they have England and Germany, they were on either side of the war. So at this time, if we want to give any benefit to shareholders, suppose we want to give dividend to shareholders, what it will become, it is like England and Germany is at war and now England company is giving dividend to Germany. So it will become like we are giving money to the enemy. So that is why in this case, the public policy is to support the war. So we should not give any benefit to our enemy country. So that is why the principle was laid down against the managing director. The corporate veil was lifted. So there was a corporate veil and they were escaping the corporate veil. So this corporate veil was lifted and this company was declared as enemy company because the shareholders are German and England and Germany are at war. Yes, it is a company registered in England, registered offices in England, everything is in England. But who is having the control? As I told you, if you see your 100% control is by German citizens. So the court lifted the corporate veil and they said that it is an enemy company since the persons who are in control of the company are residents of Germany and Germany and England are at war. So when war is there, it is against the public policy to help the enemy. So here we can lift the corporate veil. Next, we can lift the corporate veil when the corporate identity is only an agency. So when corporate identity is only an agency for some other job. So here, let us try to understand. There is an American company. So that film, it's a film company. They make films. And this American company is having a registration in a British company which 90% shareholding. Okay, so in the British company, 90% shareholding is held by the American company and 10% is held by others. So the majority control is by the American company. So the England company acted merely as a nominee of the American company. That is clearly easily understandable, because only 10% is owned by the British or England company. British England is one and the same. But the American company is owning 90%. So here in this case, what happened is they wanted to register a film. A film has to be registered and there is some fees to be paid. So if it is basically a British film, the fees will be very less. So what they did is they told that this British company is the owner of the film, but actually 90% is owned by the American company. So that is when the court lifted the corporate veil. So the court lifted the corporate veil and saw the shareholding, and they told that just to save the fees, just because it is British company, fees is less. You are trying to show it as a British company. Actually, it is American company, because control is by the American company. So the corporate veil was lifted and the film was not allowed to be registered as a British film. It had to be registered as an American film, because the Board of Trade refused this and they said that it is clearly that the English company is only a nominee of the American company. So these are examples of how we can lift the corporate veil and what are the circumstances. Now we will do the last part of this chapter, illegal association. Illegal association. This is the last concept in this first chapter, and we have to know what is the meaning of an illegal association. So in first chapter, even if you don't get sometimes direct question, but the knowledge of first chapter will help you to answer the different questions. So the illegal association is basically saying that any entity which has more than a certain number of people. So it has a ceiling on number of persons, ceiling on number of persons in an association. Ceiling on number of persons in an association or a partnership. So that means what is the maximum number of people you can have without the registration. So that we call as an illegal association. So if you have an association without registration, more than the maximum number of people prescribed, it will be called as an illegal association. So we have to refer to section 464 of the Companies Act, which says that registration is mandatory to be a legal association. Mandatory registration to be called as a legal association. So you have to compulsorily register. So next thing is that this does not apply to HUF. So does not apply to Hindu undivided family. Now that we know that if we have a number of people where we have not registered, then it will be called illegal association. We should know what is the number. So for that, we have to refer to the Rule 10. So we have to refer to Rule 10 of the company's miscellaneous rules. So company's miscellaneous rules 2014. So this rule says that 50 persons, that means if we have any association which is more than 50 per person, but it is unregistered. So if it is unregistered as having more than 50, we call it as illegal association. So that is very important for us to understand. So any association or partnership will be called as illegal if it is not being registered with more than 50 people. So now there is one interesting case law relating to illegal association. So this case law will help us understand what is the meaning of illegal association. So that is the case law of Kumaraswamy Chettiar. Kumaraswamy Chettiar versus income tax officer. So this was a very old case, 1957. So this case said that illegal association is taxable. They may be illegal, but they have to pay the tax. So for income tax department, everybody is legal. Even if you are not registered or unregistered, it doesn't matter. Illegal association has to pay taxes. So they are liable for taxes. So this is was told in this case. So if you have any association more than 50 people which is not registered, we call it as an illegal association, because it is having the ceiling of the number of people where we can be having business without registration. So if you have more than 50, it is definitely illegal. So section 464 talks about the mandatory registration if you want to call yourself a legal association. This comes to the end of lesson 1, which is introduction of company law.